Yeah, she was letting me know. Good morning, everybody. My name is Laura Bannon. I am the project manager for the Youth Climate Report.
Thank you, Laura. Thank you very much. And welcome, everybody, to the 11th edition of the Youth Climate Report. We're very happy and proud to present more than 100 films this year at COP27. A lot of these films were made over the course of the past year, and we focused on underrepresented Indigenous communities from the Global South. So a lot of the films that you're going to see throughout the conference will be represented by those communities. Now, since loss and damage funding is a very high priority here at COP27 this year, it's very important that these films be seen because they provide the visible evidence of that loss and damage. So let's begin. Okay, just a quick background on the Youth Climate Report so you understand. It's the first GeoDoc, a multi-linear interactive database documentary film project presented on a platform of a geographic information system map of the world. It has an unlimited capacity for video content produced by the global community of youth aged 18 to 30. Each pin contains a documentary short, approximately 5 minutes in length, along with metadata related to the content of each film, things like scientific papers, location coordinates, links to researchers and their organizations, dates of production, and the names of the young filmmakers. The project currently showcases nearly 700 videos of climate-related and sustainable development goals research, impacts, and programs on all seven continents. Laura?
The goals of the Youth Climate Report. Need to click. Thank you. to provide a visual data delivery system of new climate research, impacts, and solutions from around the world to the delegates of the COP conferences. To provide a voice for youth around the world so they may be heard at the COP conferences. And to provide a voice to the global scientific community so their latest research will reach the environmental policymakers of the United Nations. And here is, you will see a map of our geodoc, and so you can access that on the by the link at the bottom of the screen. And you'll notice all of those points are different videos from around the world, and the different colors represent the different years that each video was produced and added to the map.
Thank you, Laura. One of the first projects that we did this year was called the Planetary Health Film Lab, and we went to Ecuador and worked with the indigenous youth from that country. Now in its third year, the Planetary Health Film Lab is an interdisciplinary program featuring a week-long intensive workshop designed to provide participants with the knowledge, skills, and tools to make short documentary films for the United Nations. The 2022 edition of the Planetary Health Film Lab was designed for indigenous youth from 11 different communities across Ecuador who have a story to tell about climate and climate change and health and want to do so through film. A total of 16 films were produced in the indigenous languages of Quechua and Shuar with English subtitles. Now this is particularly important this year because 2022 represents the first year of the UN's International Decade for Indigenous Languages. Many of the stories centered on reduced amounts of water by way of droughts and industrial contamination. This resulted in poor and reduced crop production, causing a food shortage to many of Ecuador's indigenous communities living in the mountains, valleys, and the Amazon jungle.
And we will be premiering a selection of these films in the Children and Youth Pavilion on November 11th at 5 o'clock. So.
And
causa de que primera vez respaca hasta 30 años cuenta ca chepica kushnika tutan de punjandi nina kushniko na joshi hopi impactante carian amma chai mapa mundo na rehta rico y nyuka paka ya ki pacha carian europa de caspa. Kunan kai pachapi kausai kai momento kausai pika kai tarpu ikuna pika ungu I alita pacha jakichina cho por ejemplo punda ka touka variedad papa kunata chari kariachi I kai nyukanchi jakta pinishu kai agato urku kunapi pas papa taka tarpu kaga karianchi fukuchin karianchi pero kunan bika nya papa taka nya na tarpu ushan kai fabrika kuna factoría chay sisa ta tarpu chay yaki mapa chay contaminación chay químico kuna tukuy laduma afectan kankashka soberanía alimentaria nishka paka kay lancha ungu y milinan hatu ungu y kan.
Le sueltan polvo y el polvo se va todito al tanque de agua y está contaminado eso.
That was an example of one of the films from the Planetary Health Film Lab from Ecuador this year. Another one of our programs that we work with is the Young Reporters for the Environment. Perhaps you've heard of them. It's a program out of the Foundation for Environmental Education, at the University of Copenhagen. Each year, young people aged 11 to 25 from around the world enter a video competition with short documentary film reports on climate issues in their home countries. And just to give you an example of another one of the films out of that program, here's this.
Système marin et pêche inutilement. On les appelle filets fantômes et ils représentent 10% des déchets plastiques en mer. Pour les pêcheurs, leur perte coûte cher, entre 2000 et 3000 euros en moyenne. À Marseille, une chercheuse étudie leur impact.
Le filet, il ne disparaîtra jamais parce que il sera toujours, sa matière sera toujours présente dans le milieu sous forme de microplastique. Donc de toute façon, il ne disparaîtra jamais.
À 8 km d'ici, les plongeurs de l'association Palana se préparent. Aujourd'hui, ils remontent un filet signalé il y a 6 mois et bloqué à 30 mètres sous l'eau. La préparation est rigoureuse. Avant les premières plongées, les bénévoles ont évalué le potentiel impact du retrait. C'est ensuite qu'ils sont passés à l'action.
On le décoince, on le met en tension avec des parachutes. Donc les parachutes, c'est des gros sacs qu'on remplit d'air qui permettent de remonter le filet. Et petit à petit, en décoinçant le filet, il va finir par remonter jusqu'à la surface. Donc ça demande à pas mal de travail de minutie au fond à décoincer le filet petit à petit, en limitant l'impact sur les espèces, surtout sur les espèces dressées de type corail et gorgone, qui peuvent être très impactées par les filets de ce type.
1500 filets comme celui-ci sont répertoriés dans le littoral méditerranéen français. Un chiffre loin d'être exhaustif. Pour traiter la source du problème, direction le Var, où l'entreprise CLS élabore une balise GPS. Elle sera capable de localiser les filets en temps réel.
La technologie réside dans cette petite puce-là. Cela émet un signal vers des satellites et l'écoute de ce signal depuis des satellites que l'on dit défilants, donc des satellites qui tournent autour de la Terre en orbite basse, permet de géolocaliser, de savoir d'où le signal a été émis. À quelques dizaines de mètres, on sait géolocaliser tout terminal, tout objet équipé de cette petite puce.
Une dizaine de pêcheurs de la région expérimentent la balise. Parmi eux, Pierre Morera. En activité depuis 33 ans, il ne compte plus les filets perdus.
Ouais, en fait, ça va nous simplifier la vie parce que ça va permettre d'avoir en permanence un œil sur le matériel qui est à l'eau. Donc, le matériel nous coûte très cher, c'est le matériel qui est fait maison. Donc chaque pêcheur a sa façon de monter son matériel. Et donc c'est quand même précieux lorsqu'on rentre à la maison de pouvoir regarder avant de se coucher où est le matériel. S'il n'a pas bougé, s'il n'y a pas eu de soucis dessus.
Le coût d'achat, estimé à 100 euros, convainc Pierre Morera. Mais certains de ses collègues pêcheurs restent méfiants. Localiser son matériel, c'est montrer ses secrets de pêche. L'idée permettrait quand même de réduire la pollution. Selon WWF, la Méditerranée affiche la concentration de microplastiques la plus élevée au monde. Si ces filets sont perdus,
okay, that was another example of some of the films that we've added to the database of the Youth Climate Report this year. Also coming out are a couple of books that the Youth Climate Report is heavily featured in. The first is called Speaking Youth to Power, Influencing Climate Policy at the United Nations. This is part of my academic research. I'm a professor at York University in Toronto, Canada. And this book is being published by Palgrave Macmillan and is expected to come out next month. The other book is called The Emerging Role of Geomedia in the Environmental Humanities. We actually have a copy of it here. Laura is showing it. Very good, thank you. And that's a collection of scholarly papers regarding using GIS technology, geographic information systems, in collecting databases of film reports that the United Nations can often use as a data delivery system. So those are our two books. So what's next for the Youth Climate Report? Well, we have a project called Protectors. Laura?
Yeah, so coming out soon in 2023 is Protectors. Protectors is a short documentary series produced by Rewild Africa and the Youth Climate Report that explores the stories of underrepresented conservationists who are protecting or restoring ecosystems around the globe.
And we have a very short little trailer we'd like to share with you.
Apartheid didn't only forcibly remove people from their homes and put them in the group areas, but they also denied access to natural spaces. People lost connection with natural spaces that they had grown up with, that their elders had grown up with, and that their ancestors had grown up with. Unemployment, drug addiction, alcoholism, gangsterism. And that's the reality for a lot of kids in the Cape Flats. Princess Flair, just like other spaces, were also allocated to people of color. It was a space where they could be human.
To the south of Princess Flair, you've got Cape Flats Jungstrandfout, which is an endangered vegetation type endemic to the city of Cape Town. To the north of Princess Flair, you've got Cape Flats sand fynbos, which is a critically endangered vegetation type. And those two vegetation types meet around the Flair. We are restoring that unique mix where those two plant communities meet.
Looking at plants, taking in the smell, learning to communicate with my environment, those are like some of the things that we don't get taught. And those are Indigenous teachings.
So there you go. And finally, just some contact information and our social media handles for you. There's our project website. We have a website on the UNFCCC's website. Email for myself and for Laura is there. And our Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube accounts. Please subscribe and follow us as much as you can. I'd also like to take this opportunity to properly introduce Laura Bannon. She is our project manager, but this is her very first COP and her very first press conference, and I think she did a wonderful job. Don't you?
Thank you.
Okay, we do have some time for questions. If there's any questions on any of our projects or any of our films, happy to answer.
Hi, good morning. I'm Liang Lei from Eco Business in Singapore. Thanks for the presentation. Just one quick question. I just know you mentioned the objectives of compiling the films is so that global youths have a voice at COP, their voices can be heard. Can I just ask, do you have any measure of success of how their voices have been heard?
Thank you. That's an excellent question. And the project, the Youth Climate Report, began 11 years ago specifically for the purpose of amplifying the voice of youth at these COP conferences. And they do it through film. And we add them all together on this interactive map so that the policymakers and other delegates attending the conference can access these videos and see a lot of the visible evidence that's being provided by the young people, the global community of youth, as to how climate change is impacting on their respective communities. And that evidence is then introduced to the negotiation sessions. And so they end up having a direct impact through the surrogacy of film. They're not physically here themselves, but their voices are still heard through these video projects. So we've been very happy with the results of this project.
And if I may add on to that as well, I think amongst young people, there's a lot of frustration and a lot of anger that they don't feel that their opinions are being heard. So being able to, even though it's not in person, but being able to bring more of those voices so they do have a medium to make an impact on policy making around the world.
Hi, thank you. I was wondering, are the youth that produce these films financially compensated for their work? And if not, is that in discussions or what's the mechanism around that?
Thank you. That's a good question. It's a question we get almost every year. no, they are not compensated for it, but they are trained through a series of seminars and workshops, and they work with professionals and other academics that are experts in the fields of environmental studies and climate change and planetary health. So they are provided with transportation to a central city. They are given accommodations and they are given meals. So during this period of workshop, they're not compensated directly with money, but they are with education and opportunity.
Is there a plan for key decision makers at the UN to watch these films at COP27?
Yes, there is. There's two events where we're showing these films here at COP this year. One of them is on November the 9th at 4:45 p.m. and that's at a side event, and we're going to be showcasing the Indigenous films made by the youth from Ghana. So in keeping with the Africa theme of being here in Egypt, we're going to be showcasing the films from Ghana, and that's a very special presentation. I hope you guys can make it for that. And we also have another presentation of the films from Ecuador that we saw, and that's going to take place November the 11th, right, Laura?
Yep, at 5 p.m. in the Children and Youth Pavilion.
Any other questions? Okay, we're available after the press conference. If you come and see us and talk to us some more, we can give you a Youth Climate Report pin that you can proudly wear. And if you're interested in our new book, we have a few copies available for the media as well. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
That's okay.